morning.
Good morning.
We all on 15?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to try to race through three of these today and maybe four, okay, because the ones tomorrow are going to be a little bit long. Okay, so this one's all about circuits and stuff, so now we get into electronics. Okay, so here we have a little circuit, and this is a battery. This is a symbol for a battery. This is a symbol for some kind of resistance. It could be a light bulb, a hairdryer, doesn't make any sense, but it's called a load. So let's talk about this. It's an electromotive force, EMF, is called voltage. It will cause electrons to flow in a circuit. So there's a battery in my hand, and if we put it in a circuit, we connect it up to something over here, current will flow in the circuit, but we have volts. And there's your volts across here. So the basic unit of EMF is called the volt. Okay, so EMF is measured as volts. And how do we measure it? Well, we measure it with a volt meter. Now, this meter right over here actually will measure volts. So if I want to measure how many volts something is, I take these two leads and I put it across the battery, and there you go, I can measure it. Okay? Now, you notice I said I put it across the battery because the voltmeter is connected in parallel with whatever I'm trying to measure. Okay? The voltage across something. Okay. This is typical mobile transceivers. That's this guy here, right? My mobile transceiver, require 12 volts because we connect it to the battery. And connected both leads directly to the battery, and the negative lead, which would be the black one, will go to the ground strap of the engine, and the positive lead will go to the other one. So this is all I want you to know, okay? So, volts. Now, once we connect voltage, and we put something, put a little load on it, that's the resistor here, then we get current flowing, okay? So when electrons are in the circuit, it's called current. So it's actually electrons that are flowing in the circuit. The basic unit of current is the ampere. We measure amps, or we measure current with an amp meter, and that same meter will measure amps. And amp meters connect in series with the circuit. So we're trying to figure out how much current is flowing through the circuit, so we have to put an amp meter in series with it. So voltage is kind of like, voltage is like the pressure in a water pipe, and current is like how much water is flowing through it. Okay. Okay, so got two pictures here now. Here's a battery connected onto a load. There's current flowing. Now, if I took a picture of how much current, if I took a picture of the battery, here's a picture, here's a cool picture. So I get E plus, right? I get E plus volts as long as I left my little meter on there. Okay. Now, here's a different kind of a voltage source. And take a notice here that this voltage goes plus, then it goes minus, and it goes plus and minus. Well, every time it goes plus, the current goes in one direction. When it goes minus, the current goes in the other direction. So what do we got here? Current that flows only in one direction is called DC, direct current. That's what comes out of a battery, direct current. Current that flows in one direction then reverses the direction is called alternating current, AC. That's what comes out of the wall, okay? AC is what comes out of our walls. And frequency is the number of times per second that the alternating current changes direction. So when you say, gee, what's the frequency of what's coming out of that wall? Well, it's 110, 120 volts, and it's 60 hertz. And that means that voltage goes plus and minus, 60 times every second.
I have a moment to hear it.
We'll call you.
No.
So we have two times the voltages. AC, DC. Okay. A little different subject. There's things called insulators and things called conductors. So what's a good conductor? Good conductors tend to be something metal, piece of wire. Okay. Copper is a very good conductor. That's your question. The better the conductor, the less resistance. Which that doesn't mean anything to you now, but too much resistance in a conductor is bad. Okay. This is all you got to remember is one about copper. And this thing's called insulator. So good insulators tend to be non-metallic. Like, okay, so a good insulator would be glass. Okay. The better the insulator, the more the resistance, which is good. The very high resistance stops the flow of current, which is what you want when you have an insulator. Okay. So there's like two questions here for you. Okay, now we're going to get to some of these different parts. The first one's resistors. What they call resistance is called resistors. Okay. Here's a symbol. You don't have to memorize that. Anytime you see a symbol in the electronics world with an arrow on it, that means it's a variable, whatever it is. So this is a resistor, this is a variable resistor. Okay, all kind of resistors. Here's a big one right here. Okay. Here's a little small one right here. And of course, in transistor circuits, they're even smaller. Okay? So a resistor, what it does is it opposes the flow of current, electrons, in the circuit. It opposes it. The more resistance I have, the less current's going to flow. So the basic unit of resistance is called the ohm, O-H-M. To measure resistance, we use an ohm meter. Okay? Then there's a thing called a potentiometer. Okay? That's this little guy here. It used to be, what this is a resistor inside. But this third little point is is this thing here. And as I turn this knob like that, this little thing can move from one end of the resistor to the other end. In the older radios we used to have, this used to be our volume controls. This was a volume control. Potentiometer, they call it. So the potentiometer controls how much resistance. Well, doesn't control resistance from here to here. It controls resistance from here to one end or here to the other end. That's what it's all about. Potentiometer. So another form of electronic part is called the inductor. Okay, so inductor is nothing but a coil of wire. So here's a coil of wire sitting on this little piece of PVC. Okay? There's a symbol for it right over there. So a conductor is kind of like the earth. When you pass current through the conductor, through the coil, we get a magnetic field. It's like the North Pole and the South Pole. You get this magnetic field that goes around it like that. Okay? So an inductor is a coil of wire, and when current passes through it, energy is stored. Energy is stored now in the magnetic field. The energy in that field out there. Okay? So storing energy in a magnetic field is called inductance, and the basic unit of inductance is called the Henry. Just memorize those answers. Not do any more than that. And then another popular device is called the capacitor. A capacitor is really like two surfaces, two metal surfaces that are separated. You can't touch, they're separated. And there's a symbol for capacitor. So a capacitor is basically two parallel conductive surfaces separated by some kind of insulation if you don't want them to touch. See, and here's a capacitor. Now what you're not seeing is you're not seeing all the two surfaces that are wrapped around with something separating, but there's the two wires right there. So storing, and in fact, let me show you this. Here's a variable capacitor, and you can see now, there's a set of plates here and a set of plates here, and I can make that do that. And I have a whole bunch of these surfaces, okay? But because I can do this, I have a variable capacitor, changing the amount of capacitance. Okay? So, storing energy in electric field is called capacitance, and it's done by a capacitor. And the basic unit of capacitance is called the farad. Okay? All that? Okay, now we're going to get into circuits a little bit. I'm going to tell you about power supply circuits. Now, what's a power supply? Well, power supply, if you like this thing here, remember, I talked about this. I have this mobile radio. It works in my car, but it takes 12 volts DC. How do I use it in a house? Well, I buy a power supply that I can plug into my wall, 110 volts AC, and it does something in here and comes out with 12 volts DC. So the power supply converts AC to DC, and I can run this radio in my house. Here's a power supply, and here's part of the schematic, it's part of the circuit. So 110 volts comes in here, there's a transformer, and then it goes through a circuit, which is called a rectifier circuit, and some other things happen with capacitors, inductors, and out comes the voltage I want, okay? So let's see what it says. Typical power supply changes alternating current, AC, into direct current, DC. So the rectifier circuit does the AC to DC change right there. That thing right there takes these little sine waves and make it look something like this, okay? The diodes in the rectifier circuit allow the current to only flow in one direction. I won't bother you about that because it's a little technical, but when this is going positive, only certain diodes are active, and when this goes negative, the other diodes are active. Just memorize the answer. Okay? It's very, like, very technical. The two electrodes in a diode are the, now this is the symbol for a diode. This is the actual symbol. One of its electrodes is called the anode, and one's called the cathode. So the two electrodes in the diode are the anode and the cathode, and the cathode is the strike point. Now, it also turns out that current only flows in one direction through a diode. Which direction? Well, take a look at this one here. See the little arrow? Current will flow in this direction, but it will not flow in this direction. So when this is positive, it says, hey, where am I going to go? Oh, I can flow through here. I can flow through this circuit. I can flow through this one, and I can come back here. Good. So, and when this is negative, it says, oh, let's see. When I'm negative, it's positive over here, so this is, oh, I can flow through here, through the circuit. And back through here, here. So, using rectifiers only flow, let current flow in one direction. Okay, a little different device now. Here's a transistor. There's a couple symbols. There's different kinds of transistors. I've got a big one here. But obviously, there's super tiny ones that are in our computers and cell phones. But there's two kinds of transistors. There's two symbols for this kind of transistor. And you don't have to memorize much, but this one that has three little connections to it. And this one has three connections, but these are different kinds of transistors. The signal that goes in, always goes in what's called the base, goes in here, and the signal comes out over here, and it gets amplified. Okay. So a transistor is a solid-state conversion of a vacuum tube. So in the old days, we had the big vacuum tubes. Now we have transistors and little smaller transistors. Okay. So transistors can be used as an electronic switch or as an amplifier. Now, what does it mean as a switch? Well, I can put a signal in here that I can put my audio signal in here, and it comes out of here, and it amplifies it. Okay. Or I can put a voltage here that'll stop the current from flowing. I can put a voltage here that'll let the current flow. So I can either use it as an amplifier or as a switch, either one. The ability of a transistor to amplify a signal is called its gain. So if I can put a signal here that's all so big, but when it comes out here it's 10 times stronger, then I amplified the signal. I gave it a gain of 10. So that's how it works as an amplifier. Applying a voltage or current signal can control the current flow through the transistor. That's true. When you put about a voltage here and pass some current through, it controls the amount of current that flows through here and the amount of voltage that comes out here. That's what it does. It's a little control mechanism. Okay? You put something at the input, you get something at the output. It says transistors with an emitter electrode are called bipolar. Well, okay, well, these all have emitters. Okay, the type I'm showing you has emitters. Now they're called bipolar. When something is bi something, what does that mean? Two. Got it. So what that means is I can make this thing switch on or switch off. I can put a voltage here, I can put some voltage here, or put zero. When I put something here, this will switch on. I put nothing here, it switches off. So that's bipolar. Two states. So another version of a transistor is called a bipolar junction transistor. It's made up of three layers of semiconductors. Just memorize that. I don't have the symbol for that, and it's not worth getting into it. So when something says it's got three layers, it's a different type of a bipolar. Okay. There's one called a field effect transistor. Just memorize this too. The abbreviation is FET, field effect transistor. And FET is a gate electrode. Just memorize this, and don't really worry about this. This is something referencing to a book that you don't have. But just memorize the fact that FET means field effect transistor, and it's an electronic, it has a gate electrode. And lots of modern ham gear uses powerful transistors that have FETs in them. So just memorize that stuff. Okay, now we're going to talk about, just briefly, I've got something that I plug in. Doesn't make any difference what it is. I just plug it in. Okay? And maybe it could be this power supply. Yeah. Just be the power supply. I just plug it in. And I got a switch here. Turns it on and off. There's a switch right there. Okay. And right after the switch, I've got a fuse. Okay, so let's see what it says. The switch is used to connect the circuit. Yep, that's right. There's the switch right there. Here's the switch right here. So when the switch is off, it's like this. So the circuit is open. And with no electrons can flow into the circuit because the switch is open. I turn the switch on. Bingo. It's shorted out, and now current can flow in the circuit, and the power supply works. Okay. So the switch above is referred to as a single pole, single throw. Don't have to memorize that. A fuse is used to protect the circuit components from overload. What does that mean? So in this case here, I got a fuse. Well, you've all probably seen these little small cylinder fuses, right? Well, of course, we have fuses in our houses too. So what happens is, let's say that I try to take too much power out of this strange, this power supply thing. Well, what keeps the power supply from